Good evening, friends. Today we will discuss about qualitative analysis of carbonyl compounds. It means that how to identify the carbonyl compounds in our laboratory by doing some tests. Okay, so let us come to carbonyl compounds. Okay, what are carbonyl compounds? Carbonyl compounds are nothing but aldehydes and ketones, because both the compounds containing the common group that is called C double bond O. So these are called aldehydes containing a radical. These are carbonyl group containing another compounds called ketones. So what about aldehydes and what about ketones? Structurally, what is the difference between these two particular carbonyl compounds? Here the carbonyl group is substituted by one of the carbon containing radical and hydrogen. In the case of ketones, carbonyl group is connected by or substituted by two similar carbon containing radicals or dissimilar carbon containing radicals. Like, we will see some examples. Here CH3CHO. Here the carbonyl group is connected with only one carbon containing radical, that is alkyl radical, is nothing but methyl radical. In this particular case, the carbonyl group is connected with two carbons directly, but in this particular case only one carbon, the rest of substitution is hydrogen. Here the hydrogen is replaced with another carbon containing radical. That radical may be alkyl radical, aryl radical, or any hetero cyclic radical. Okay, so these are the differences between aldehydes and ketones. Here the carbonyl group is common for both the compounds, but in aldehydes carbonyl group is connected with or substituted by only one carbon containing radical. The another substitution is hydrogen. Here both are carbon containing substituents. Those may be similar or dissimilar. In the first example, that is dimethyl ketone or acetone. In the second example, one is alkyl radical, another one is aryl radical, is none other than acetophenone. So here also you can take aryl radical with the carbonyl group, the another substitution is hydrogen. That is the, see, these are the different types of examples of aldehydes and ketones. Okay, let us come to our actual topic, that is qualitative analysis of carbonyl compounds. What is qualitative analysis? How to identify the quality of a particular organic chemical by doing some tests or analysis. So here, before going to know about the qualitative analysis test, first of all we should have to know about what is the reactivity of these compounds, whether aldehydes are more reactive or ketones are more reactive. We will see now. Okay, see, in this particular case, in this particular case, oxygen is partially electronegative, carbon is partially electropositive. Here also partially electronegative, partially electropositive. In this case, only one electron donating group, one electron donating group, electron donating group substituted to the electrophilic carbon atom. Here electron donating groups, this one and this one. It means here the electrophilicity can be compensated by electron donating group. Hence, some electrophilicity at carbonyl carbon. Some electrophilicity at carbonyl carbon. Here, the electrophilicity at carbonyl compound is almost negligible. Electrophilicity is negligible because here only one electron donating group, here two electron donating groups are there, so that's why among these two it acts as somewhat electrophilic in nature, but it's not at all. That's why it is looking for a nucleophile. But what about this one? No need. So it is more reactive. This is less reactive. You can also know about the reactivity of these aldehydes and ketones from other aspect also. See, you know very well about the aldoses and ketoses. Aldoses are nothing but aldehyde group containing sugars. Ketoses are nothing but ketone group containing sugars. So, aldehyde group containing carbohydrates or sugars are called aldoses. Ketone group containing sugars or carbohydrates are called ketoses. Let us come to two examples. In the glycolysis process, you can see the two intermediates. One is glyceraldehyde 3-phosphate. This is glyceraldehyde 3-phosphate. This is dihydroxyacetone phosphate. If you observe the glycolysis carefully, glucose converted to glucose 6-phosphate in the first step. Second step that undergo isomerization to yield fructose 6-phosphate. In the third step, in presence of aldose, fructose 6-phosphate converted to fructose 1,6-bisphosphate. Up to that, you no need to get any particular doubt. From there, in presence of aldolase enzyme, this glyceraldehyde undergo further metabolism rather than dihydroxyacetone phosphate. In the first step, in the presence of kinase, glucose 6-phosphate is formed. In presence of isomerase, that undergo fructose 6-phosphate. In presence of another kinase, that is fructose 1,6-bisphosphate. So lateral it undergo cleavage in presence of the enzyme is called aldolase. That aldolase produces aldehyde sugar phosphate and ketone sugar phosphate. Lateral the metabolism starts from glyceraldehyde 3-phosphate only, not from dihydroxyacetone phosphate, because this is more reactive than this one. That's the reason this ketone sugar again undergo isomerization to yield glyceraldehyde 3-phosphate. So that's why in glycolysis, from here there are two metabolic reactions. One is from glyceraldehyde 3-phosphate, another one is from after isomerization of dihydroxyacetone phosphate, the same reactions occur in the glycolysis. Okay, that is the other evidence why aldehydes are more reactive than ketones. Okay, next, let us come to what are the different tests of these aldehydes and ketones. Let us see. Generally, these aldehydes and ketones no need to test individually because these are more reactive than these. Okay? So anyhow, to identify both the compounds, what is the common functional group? Carbonyl functional group. That's why some common tests are there. So, common tests. Common tests. What are the common tests? First one is 2,4 dinitrophenyl hydrazine test. 2,4 dinitrophenyl hydrazine. Second one is sodium bisulfite test. Okay, these two tests mainly used to identify the carbonyl functional group. Carbonyl functional group. That means if you get positive result in these particular two tests, you can confirm that your sample is carbonyl compound. Either that may be aldehyde or ketone. So that's why these are not at all the confirmatory tests for either aldehydes or ketones. That's why these are called common tests. Let us come to what are these common tests in the case of first test. What is the first test? 2,4 dinitrophenyl hydrazine test. In this particular case, just you take the sample, either it may be aldehyde or ketone. If you add the reagent 2,4 dinitrophenyl hydrazine, these two compounds undergo the particular reaction to yield hydrazone complex. 2,4 dinitrophenyl hydrazone complex. This is orange red color precipitate. Okay, to your sample just add 2,4 dinitrophenyl hydrazine. That gives orange red color hydrazone complex. That indicates your compound is either, your compound may be either aldehyde or ketone. Let's come to sodium bisulfite test. In the case of sodium bisulfite test, just to your sample add sodium bisulfite. That gives water soluble by sulfides. It is none other than colorless product. In the qualitative analysis, we have to identify the color reaction. So that's why in the identification of carbonyl compounds like aldehydes and ketones, we are using these particular qualitative tests only, but not sodium bisulfate. So this is the commonly used qualitative test for carbonyl compounds like aldehydes or ketones. Okay, so this is the common test for carbonyl compounds, but there is no specific test discussed yet. Okay, so in the 2,4 DNP test, to your sample add 2,4 DNP reagent. Thereby you will be getting an orange red color precipitate that indicates your sample is either aldehyde or ketone. Or you can do this. If you do this particular test also, you can't able to identify whether your sample is formed the product or not, because that is the colorless solution. Okay, let's come to the specific reactions or confirmatory tests or distinction between aldehydes and ketones. How can we distinguish whether our compound is aldehyde or ketone? So for that, see, this is more reactive, this is less reactive. So these aldehydes readily undergo oxidation. No oxidation. So that's why you have to add some oxidizing reagents. If you add oxidizing reagent, your compound undergo oxidation. If you add oxidizing reagent here, your compound does not undergo any particular oxidation reaction. So what are those oxidizing reagents? So in the first test, just you add Fehling's reagent. Second one, Benedict's reagent. Third one, Tollens reagent. Fourth one, Skips reagent. All these particular reagents give a particular product. That means your compound undergo the specific reaction that is called oxidation to yield the colorful product or precipitate of the solution. What about these ketones? They won't give because they are highly inert when those are subjected to any particular oxidating agent, because ketones do not undergo oxidation. If aldehydes undergo oxidation, they produce carboxylic acids. Okay, let's come to Fehling's reagent. Okay, so if you take, to your sample, add Fehling's reagent and keep it in the water bath for 10 minutes, you will be getting orange or red color precipitate that indicates your compound is aldehyde. For example, after addition of this Fehling's reagent to your sample, if you did not get any particular orange red color precipitate, that indicates your compound is ketone because these are not at all reactive. Okay, but you have to perform this particular test after the commonly used test. What is the 2,4-DNP test? After conclusion of the 2,4-DNP test, you have to perform. To your sample, you add 2,4-DNP reagent. If you get any particular orange red color precipitate, that indicates your compound is carbonyl compound. In that particular case, if you did not get any particular precipitate or the solution, your compound is not at all a carbonyl compound. So later, you no need to perform these particular tests. Okay, next. In the second case, after getting the positive result from 2,4-DNP, first you do this Fehling's test. Later on, Benedict's. Same to your sample, add Benedict's reagent. Same result. Orange red color precipitate. That indicates your compound is aldehyde. If there is no precipitate, your compound is ketone. You come to Tollens reagent. So, Tollens test. To your sample, add Tollens reagent. Of course, in this Tollens and Fehling's, you will be getting two particular reagents. Fehling's A, Fehling's B. Tollens A, Tollens B. Okay? So, combine both the reagents, then you add the sample. Here also combine both the Tollens A and Tollens B and add the sample. you will be getting to your sample, add tollens reagent and shake well. So you will be getting silver mirror. Silver mirror on the inner walls of the test tube. Inner walls of the test tube that indicates your sample is aldehyde. If you did not get any particular silver mirror, that indicates your sample is ketone. Let's come to Skip's test. Take your sample, just here, Skip's reagent. Okay, so you can get the composition of these particular reagents from your biochemistry practicals. Or otherwise, Fehling's reagent, copper sulfate in acidic and basic media along with Rochelle salt. This is also copper sulfate in acetate, ammonical silver nitrate. Okay, this is sodium bisulfite in fission dye. Okay, you can get this particular reagent composition from somewhere. Yeah, Skip's reagent. What is Skip's reagent? I mean, what does this Skip's reagent do to your aldehyde? It produces pink color solution. Pink color solution. That indicates your compound is aldehyde. If there is no pink color solution production, that indicates your sample is ketone. This is the way how qualitative analysis to be carried out for carbonyl compounds like aldehydes and ketones. Let us see what are the common examples or what are the common aldehydes used in our particular laboratory to perform these particular qualitative analysis. Or now I will tell you the structures of some carbonyl compounds commonly used in our particular laboratory. You know very well about some of the compounds. Yeah, examples of some carbonyl compounds. This is the aldehyde functional group. If it contains only one carbon, that is called formaldehyde. Okay. For example, if the aldehyde group contains benzene ring, this is called benzaldehyde. Okay, the next one. This is aldehyde. What is the name of this aldehyde? Benzaldehyde. This is ortho meta para position. Yet meta position methoxy group, para position hydroxy group. So now we can write that meta methoxy para hydroxy benzaldehyde. Again, I am telling you, this is the benzaldehyde parent molecule or parent nucleus. This is the substitution. Adjacent position is called ortho meta para. At a meta position, methoxy group. At a para position, hydroxy moiety. Now you tell me the nomenclature. Meta methoxy para hydroxy benzaldehyde. According to the chemical abstract system, you have to say that according to the alphabetical order, 4 hydroxy, 3 methoxy, H comes first, then M. So para hydroxy or 4 hydroxy. If you use numericals, you have to use numericals. If you want to write the positions, you can continue with that. So para hydroxy meta methoxy benzaldehyde. This is also called vanillin. What is that? Vanillin. Next one is what is this phenyl group substituted to propanaldehyde. Now you tell me what is this? If you start numbering from functional group containing carbon 1, 2, 3, it's a 3-phenyl propanaldehyde, but it is a unsaturated aldehyde. Now you tell me 3-phenyl 1, 2, 3. At second position, unsaturation is there. That's why 3-phenyl 2-propenaldehyde. What is that? 3-phenyl 2-propenaldehyde. Okay, this is also called cinnamaldehyde. Okay, some of the compounds can be synthesized from aldehydes, that is formaldehyde. 3 molecules of formaldehyde combine to form a condensed product, that is called, one more product is there, that is C. It is a cyclic product containing 3 oxygens. Hence, this ring name is called tri. How many oxygens? 3. Ox. It's a heterocyclic ring. 6-membered heterocyclic ring containing no nitrogen. That's why this ring is called non-nitrogenous heterocyclic. Non-nitrogenous heterocyclic rings containing 6-membered is called N. But what is the hetero atom here? Oxygen. How many? 3. Hence, triox. This N indicates non-nitrogenous 6-membered heterocyclic ring. Saturated heterocyclic ring. Hence, this ring is called trioxane. This trioxane contains 3 methyl moieties at 3 carbon atoms. Here one methyl moiety, here another methyl moiety, here another methyl moiety. So the numbering starts from hetero atom only. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. Now you tell me, trioxa. At 3 positions oxygen is there. What are those 3? 1, 3, 5. 1, 3, 5. Trioxa. Trioxane. But what about methyl moieties? 2, 4, 6. So 2, 4, 6. Trimethyl. So see the name once. It is a heterocyclic ring. That heterocyclic ring name is trioxane. Contains how many substitutions? 3 substitutions. What are their positions? 2, 4, 6. Numbering always starts from hetero atom. Hence it is called 1, 3, 5 trioxane. Whatever substitutions, according to the nomenclature, we have to write the substitutions first. 2, 4, 3 trimethyl, 1, 3, 5 trioxane. Okay. This is also called paraldehyde. Paraldehyde. Though it's not containing aldehyde group, the name itself is showing that paraldehyde, because it is obtained from 3 acetaldehyde moieties. Previously I said formaldehydes. Sorry. 3 acetaldehydes. This is one acetaldehyde. This is another acetaldehyde. This is another acetaldehyde. Condensed together, you will be getting paraldehyde. These are the commonly used aldehydes. Okay, you have to do some homework on this. What is that homework means? Write the structure of formaldehyde and at least you get 4 to 5 uses. And the second structure, benzaldehyde, write the 5 structures. Vanillin, write the 5 structures. Cinnamaldehyde, write the 5 structures. And paraldehyde, write the 5 structures. And also it contains one more structure, you know very well about that, acetone. You know very well about this, acetone. Okay, these are the six carbonyl compounds popularly used in our particular laboratory. So after the qualitative analysis, you have to write all these particular structure and uses. First you start from formaldehyde and uses, benzaldehyde uses, vanillin uses, cinnamaldehyde uses, peraldehyde uses, acetone uses. In your syllabus, two more compounds have been included. Those are nothing but hexamine and chloralhydrate. Chloralhydrate comes under alcohols. Hexamine comes under amines. Maybe it's the printing mistake. Better go with these particular examples. Okay, thank you.